Welcome to Fix It Home Improvement, covering projects that every homeowner should know and great products for home and garden.
Hi, I'm JC, and this is where we share weekly home improvement tips. I'm here with my co-host, Cindy.
Hello, JC.
Hi, Cindy. This week, we're going to be talking about desks, and we'd like to thank Johnny Gizmo for giving us a 5-star rating and review, and I hope Johnny Gizmo is his real name. Book 11 is going to the editor soon, and you can get our previous ebooks on Amazon. They're called Home Improvement Solutions: What Every Homeowner Should Know. One of the first desks in early American homes were Bible boxes with legs. So the box had a hinged lid that slanted down in front. You would lift up on the lid and the box would be holding your Bible, and that slanted lid made a good surface to read your Bible on. Later desks, they added shelves at the back of the desk and an area to hold paper and inkwell and a quill pen, as people became more literate. The Colonial Williamsburg Foundation estimates a literacy rate of around 60% of the population between 1650 and 1670, 85% between 1758 to 1762, and 90% literacy between 1787 and 1797, and that was helped from public schooling. If you plan on setting up an office in your home or you want to add a desk in your kids' room for homework, there's quite a few different options. You can go very simple, just building your own desk, or you can get desks that you can integrate with furniture. When I was doing some of the research for our Sawhorse episode, I saw a couple of plans for building a desk using a sheet of plywood, and you cut it to the depth you want. You use 2 sawhorses as the legs and then put a filing cabinet in the middle for storage. And that would give you 2 seating areas. And if you get brackets that you can cut your own legs and your own beams, so like the McCoy super brackets we talked about, you can cut the 2x4s to any height and that 2x6 to any depth. And now you can custom make your desk.
Exciting.
If you're building a desk using plywood, you'd want an A grade on the top. It's going to be smooth, and then you can have a lower grade for the bottom, so like an AB. Some of the hardwood plywood looks good, so you can seal it or you can paint it to match your decor. And this type of rectangular desk would be considered a writing desk or a laptop computer desk. They're very simple with little or no storage. A writing desk would usually have a small drawer for pens and other items, where a computer desk would have a tray for your keyboard and your mouse, and that keeps the keyboard off your desktop, and it holds it lower, which is generally more comfortable. So if you don't need a lot of storage, a writing desk is great for paying bills, doing homework, or working on a laptop.
Okay.
In my office, I have a writing-style desk, and this was one of my mom's antique desks. It has a single drawer under the top. It's 42 inches wide, 28 inches deep, and 28 and a half inches tall. So this is great to lay out all my podcast research, so I can put 4 piles on the top part of the desk.
Is it always 4?
Yes, I always group it in 4. And then I have room on the bottom half of the desk to write and have a couple of pages that I'm working on. And then there's room for my phone, a cup of tea. So rectangular desks are very versatile. You can put them up against a wall, in a corner, away from a wall, or in the center of the room.
Okay.
Another style desk is an L-shaped desk. And with this style, it can be very simple, like a writing desk, or it can have added drawers for storage. There can be areas for wiring if you plan on using a desktop computer. Some of them come with a power cord that's built into outlets on the top of the desk or USB charging stations.
That's cool.
Yeah, so it's very convenient. My son has a writing style L-shaped desk in his room. One side is 27 inches deep to hold his monitor and a tower, and it has a tray to hold his keyboard. And that depth is good because you can change the distance of your monitor so it's more comfortable. The other side is 22 inches deep, and this is where he keeps his TV, so he can watch it from his bed or use it for gaming in his chair. L-shaped desks are going to give you a lot more workspace, but it can be more limited in its placement in most rooms. My other son has a corner desk, but his has a matching chest of drawers on one side and 2 small chests of drawers on the other side. And those 2 have hutches on top of both of them. So this is a large piece of furniture, and it's sectional, so you could add or remove pieces. A corner desk can work well in a small room or fit into a room with other furniture, like bookshelves, if you just need a place to work.
Right.
Or you can add on furniture. So if you move or if you take this to a, you know, a new home, you can now add on furniture to it if you have more room. But with a corner desk, you're stuck in a corner, usually with a door at your back. The other main type of desk is a U-shape, and this is going to give you the most workspace. It usually has a lot of drawers for storage. And depending on the style and your room size, it can be placed in a corner, in the middle of a wall, or even away from a wall. And these are the three main types, but there are a lot of variations and options. I stopped by a few furniture stores, and it's amazing how many desks have complementary pieces. You can get chests.
You think that's amazing?
Yeah. You know, I'm used to thinking of a desk and just that desk itself rather than a whole room of complementary furniture. So in this one store, they had a rectangular desk with drawers on each side of the desk, very ornate, designed to be away from the wall or in the center of the room so it shows off the front. So they called this an executive desk. And behind this desk was a writing desk, the salesperson called a credenza. So it had a shallow depth for writing with drawers on the sides and a hutch on top. And I had to look up the word.
What?
Credenza.
Credenza.
So this comes from an Italian word for the table in royal households where food was placed and tested before feeding it to royalty to make sure it wasn't poisoned. And now credenza just means a secondary work area. Hmm. A roll-top desk has a top made out of slats that can be pulled down over your desktop to hide all your paperwork and accessories. Most will have two sections of drawers, one on each side, and then a hutch-like area on top with dividers and areas to hold paperwork. These are good for organizing, storage, and writing.
Didn't your mom have one?
Yeah, that was actually mine. When I was a young guy living at home with my parents, I had that roll-top desk in my bedroom. And it had a really nice area. So one of the drawers on the bottom had a file organizer area so I could have all my files organized when I first started investing in real estate. Mm-hmm. So I could organize all my paperwork. The top was great for all my bills. And that was before I had a computer.
Were they invented yet?
When I was at one of the furniture stores, one of the salespeople said roll tops are popular with people who want to organize paperwork and have an area to write, but they don't have office space.
Or they want to hide their papers.
Right.
Like your mom.
Right, exactly.
So that roll top desk was filled.
Yeah, all her paperwork, man. So if you want a piece of furniture in your master bedroom or a living room, you can get a roll top that matches your other furniture and then just pull down that top to hide all your personal stuff. There are also large pieces of furniture that look like a closed wardrobe or an armoire that have, you open the doors and they have a pull-out keyboard and an area for a computer or a pull-out area where you can have a writing desk. And the armoire, we talked about those in some of the first homes. Those were the first closets. And in early history, it was a place to store your weapons and your armor. Floating or wall-mounted desks are mounted to your wall if you need a space to write and you don't want a big piece of furniture. You can get small decorative desks, or you can get larger sections and have multiple shelves above it for storage and decorations. A couple of the hanging desks that I looked at came with a metal rail that had to be screwed into wood studs. The instructions said, do not screw it into metal studs and do not use wall anchors. Huh. And they had a specific weight limit, like around 100 pounds that you could put on this. Standing desks are becoming more popular. U.S. News and World Report said in 2013, about 20% of professionals in offices had standing desks. In 2017, about 44%. And in 2019, about 60% of employers give the option for a standing desk.
Wow.
And there's been a lot of research about the problems with sitting for too long. Mayo Clinic says sitting too much can increase the risk of death from cardiovascular disease and cancer. And sitting for hours at a desk can increase the stress on your knees, your shoulders, and back. It can aggravate arthritis pain and increase the amount of headaches you get. Although Cornell University said there's been a study, if you're at a standing desk for long periods, you can compress your spine, increase the risk for varicose veins, and deep vein thrombosis. A study done by the American Journal of Epidemiology showed an increase in heart disease over a 12-year period studying people who stood at their desks all day.
So what are you supposed to do?
So St. John's Health Center says adding a standing desk will increase your muscle activity and circulation, but they're suggesting stand at a standing desk for 30 to 60 minutes and then go to a sitting desk for 30 to 60 minutes.
There's room for that.
So there are standing desks that can alter between standing and sitting, so it's either manual or electric. And some standing desks will sit on top of a traditional desk, so you can just use it like a workspace, and then it raises up so that you can stand at it.
Okay.
At one store, they had a desk that looked like a drafting table. It could be raised or lowered to change your desktop from standing to sitting. And this had a large workspace. They also had a smaller version with locking wheels, so you could roll it wherever you want, so you could roll it in front of a TV and work on it. Benjamin Franklin.
Because you get a lot of work done when you're watching TV.
I know. Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, and Winston Churchill all used standing desks. When you're picking a traditional sitting desk, most are around 30 inches tall. A Cornell University study says get a chair that will keep your thighs parallel to the floor and your feet flat on the floor. If you're using a computer keyboard and a mouse, you want your forearms parallel to the floor. They suggest a keyboard platform that puts the keyboard about 2 inches above your thighs. Mm-hmm. You want your wrists straight. And the desk should allow you to have the H key centered with the middle of your body. And if you have a standing desk, you want that same arm position, so your forearms parallel with the floor and your wrists straight. If you sit back in your chair or you stand up straight, your computer monitor should be about arm's length away. A couple articles I read said 20 to 30 inches is a good distance. The screen top should be tilted slightly away so you can view it with your head and your neck in a neutral upright position. So they're suggesting like a 10 to 15 degree angle. And if you extend your arm out and parallel to the floor, you should be pointing towards the center of the screen. The top of the screen should be about your eye height or slightly lower. And for most people, a couple of articles I read said a 30-inch tall desk is a little tall for most people if you're going to work for long periods. One study I read said a 30-inch tall desk is good for someone 6 feet tall, just because you can't get your arms in that 90-degree angle.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, my desk is 28.5 inches tall, and it's
because
just...
Because you're not 6 feet?
Right, 5'10", just perfect, 28.5 inches. If you're thinking about setting up an office in your home, you want to plan your desk placement around outlets, lamps, and windows. I put my desk away from the back wall, 3 feet, 3 inches away. And my back wall has windows, and I'm lined up also with an outlet for a floor lamp. So this is giving me good lighting day or night.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking forward, rather than looking at a wall, and my desk to a wall, now I'm looking the other way towards my door and my bookshelves. And with that door, I can watch my cat. When my robot feeder spins to feed my cat, I can watch her run.
Because your cat has an eating disorder.
She does. So I've got a robot feeder that has 5 little feeding ports, and it spins throughout the day on a clock. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, if you put up the bowl full of food for this cat, she will just gorge, and then she'll be hungry later on. Or she'll eat so much that then she throws it all up, and then she wants more.
Again, eating disorder.
If you have a desk with a power cord for desktop outlets or chargers, you'd want to make sure it's positioned so you aren't tripping over a cord. The Electrical Safety Foundation says never run a power cord or an extension cord under a carpet to hide it because it can overheat and cause a fire.
Mm-hmm. So my cousin built that addition on his house.
Right.
Well, it's just a new room that he made.
Right.
So he put his outlets where he's going to build a desk. He has it. How far up do you think those are, outlets are?
30 inches. Well, the average desk is 30 inches tall, so 31 inches, I'm guessing.
Because, like, when I first saw the room, I'm like, why are your outlets so high? And he said... And
I don't like to bend over.
He explained that's where he's going to build a desk.
Right.
And I'm like, oh, well, that makes sense for his printer and stuff. So he's not as crazy as I thought he was.
Your office should have enough lighting for your desktop if you're reading or writing. A study from Carnegie Mellon University suggests higher lighting levels improves productivity. Low light levels can cause fatigue and drowsiness.
Mm-hmm.
Cool colors in the blue range have been found to be stimulating for reading, doing paperwork, and keeping you alert. But a Harvard University study says don't have blue light in your room 2 to 3 hours before bed because it can suppress the release of melatonin for a good night's sleep.
You talk about this a lot.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting.
Obviously.
I spoke to a company called Torchstar about lighting for an office desk, and they're at torchstar.us. It's TORCHSTAR.US. They have...
Wow, I can't believe you haven't spelled yet.
They have LED desk lamps to increase the light on your work surface. One style they have is a desk clamp light, so it doesn't take up space on your desk. And they have a dimmable LED desk lamp that has 4 lighting modes. A reading mode, which is in the bluish range, so it's probably around 5,000 Kelvin. A studying mode, so there's less blue and more white, probably around 4,000 Kelvin. A relaxing mode, which is slightly yellower, so it's probably in that 3,000 K. And then a sleeping mode, which you would turn it to a couple of hours before you go to bed, and that's around 2,700 K. And that allows the release of melatonin for a better night's sleep. And essentially, that's what they do, like on the space station, NASA has the lighting colors change throughout the day so that it sets their sleep patterns.
Right.
Cornell University says you don't want shadows on your work surface if you're reading or writing, and they also suggest the 20-20-20 rule to reduce eye strain. Every 20 minutes, look up at an object 20 feet away for at least 20 seconds. There you go. 20-20-20. Some top-rated office desks are from Walker Edison, W-A-L-K-E-R, capital E-D-I-S-O-N, TribeSigns, it's T-R-I-B-E-S-I-G-N-S, Sauder, S-A-U-D-E-R, Jarvis, J-A-R-V-I-S, and Prepack, P-R-E-P-A-C. And then I would check out some local furniture stores if you want to integrate other pieces of furniture with a desk.
Right. Do you have anything else, Dan?
A good desk will fit your room and give you enough space to work on a variety of projects. You want to fit the desk to your height so it's comfortable. You want your forearm and your thighs parallel to the ground. Make sure it's deep enough for a computer or paperwork if you're going to be using a computer on top. And if you do a lot of computer work, a tray for your keyboard will open up your desktop and give you a lower height, which is good for most people.
Mm-hmm. Let's wrap this up.
You can subscribe to our podcast on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, CastBox, or your favorite podcast app.
If you enjoyed it, please leave us a review.
You can check out our home improvement videos on our YouTube channel, Fix It Home Improvement.
And you can subscribe to that as well.
You can download our ebooks, Home Improvement Solutions, What Every Homeowner Should Know, books 1 through 10 on Amazon.
If you enjoyed it, please leave us a 5-star rating and review.
You can email us at fixitpodcast@gmail.com. You can follow Cindy on Twitter at fixitcohost. And you can follow us on Instagram, Fix It Home Improvement.
Thank you for listening.
Talk to you next week. Deep, 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 deep